investigating the music and dance traditions of ancient India in various temples is a very interesting process. In fact, Indian iconography tells us that the dance and music were present even during the Indus Valley civilization Harappan times, because there is a beautiful dancing girl, a beautiful idol, an iconographically beautiful idol of a dancing girl at that time itself. There is a dance, there must have been the music and also the musical instruments. And we have evidences for that both archaeologically and also from several cave pictures and rock art. So the antiquity of the art has been proved archaeologically. And according to the traditional literary sources, all the iconographical and vastu traditions came from Vishwakarma in India and from Maya in the other part of the continent, that is where you now call America, but in Indian literature it is called the Atalanda, Atalam, Atalanda. Even now the ocean is now called Atlantic, you know. So the Atalanta was the place where Maya lived, and Vishwakarma was the shipy of this part of the continent, that this part of the globe, that is the eastern part of the globe. But both these people had contacts, and they had given and taken something from each other and enriched the literary sources even very, very, very early periods. Anyway, about the Vishwakarma family, they were considered as Brahmins, Vishwakarma Brahmins. Even Shankaracharya was a Vishwakarma Brahmin. And they always had a way of educating their children as a hereditary profession, as a vocational training. And the first guru was always the mother and father and the other family members. And it is said that in the morning hours, they had practical, that is vocational training. And in the evening, after Santhya, they start learning about the same thing from the textual references. So that both the theory and practice went side by side. And there had been scope for improvement, because from smaller families, they can move to other bigger families associated with them. The entire continent, subcontinent was having these Vishwakarma families here and there, and the child was free to go to any of these Gurukulas and learn and improve his profession, his vocation. And this is what is known about the iconographic education of the people. But of course, they had the knowledge of not only this vocational training, but also they had knowledge of other subjects. Now, as they moved together as a very big family, what you call the Kootu Kudumba, the big families, as a big community, they moved together, and always there will be one man and one woman at the top who will be entrusted with the duty of keeping all the other members in harmony, because there should not be any difference of opinion or anything like that. In this way, sometimes they even had the custom of one woman having several husbands even. It is said that they had even that. And from this started the Panchala, the Panchali tradition, because Panchalas or Drupatas were Mudgala Brahmins belonging to the Vishwakarma tradition. And you know about Panchali is actually a Panchajani, you know. She had to make five communities live together. So she is a Panchajani, a mother for five groups or five communities she was. So she was actually the counterpart of the Panchajanya of Krishna, the conch of Krishna, Panchajanya and Panchajini. And she is also Krishna is male, but Krishna is female, and Panjali is also the female counterpart, the Maya of the Mayavin Krishna. And if Krishna is the Yajna, Yajna Purusha, Panjali is his Yajna Seni. So, in very much connected names. And several drawings, paintings, sculptures, all these are seen in various rock and rock arts, as various rock arts and cave arts. And all these require certain use of certain tools, certain colors, the nature of the material and their antiquity, the transfer of the traditional symbols, which should have deep, essentially deep knowledge about the traditions. All these things have to be known for the Shilpi or the Vishwakarma family. And when I started to learn about this dance and music traditions in rock and cave arts and also in temples, I found probably the old, found out, I actually stumbled upon it, upon the oldest rock art showing the oldest picture of probably Krishna. And that was a real find for me actually. I haven't seen any of that such a thing in any other rock art except that one. So that was actually, I actually stumbled upon that Krishna image. And it's a great experience for me. Now, for this, another thing is that the Shilpi by nature has to develop his own Swanubhava, his own experience. That experience he has to cultivate, then he has to strengthen that experience by lyrical, that is kavitva, the literary traditions, the kavitva of the country, the musical traditions, the sangeeta of the country, then the other fine arts, painting, drawing, the sense of colors, all these things he should have. And also the human figures, thus what you call the Samudrika Shastra, that also he should know. And above all, he should have the knowledge of the bhavas, how people show their bhava rasa, because words are not used in iconography. So they should have very deep experience, and they should have that in their nature to depict that on a stone image or on any image. So their skills have to be multiple ability, what you call the multiple intelligence theory of Howard Gardner. It was practiced several thousands and thousands of years ago by our Shilpis. It is a multiple intelligence theory. They should know mathematics, basic mathematics, to prepare a vastu. So people say that vastu shastra is not a shastra, modern people. I don't know how they say that. It is pure mathematics, no? Vastu shastra is mathematics, pure mathematics. If mathematics is not a science, what else is science? So a Shilpi has to know, a vastu Shilpi has to know the pure mathematics, first of all. Then the natural phenomena in each part, geographical and natural phenomena, the availability of the material in each part. Then he should know the fine arts like painting, dance, music. He should be aware of the mythology, about the scriptures, about the legends. Then the aesthetics of everything. And Banasara, one of the iconographic texts, also says that Vedas have to be known. So arts and science, the beauty of life, the integral part of the society with a clearly defined role. All these things together, what we call a vastu shilpi or a shilpi, an iconographer. And according to the oldest Chalukya cave temple traditions, the oldest of the Vishwakarma tradition is called Ojas. Ojas was the previous incarnation of Krishna in a mother called Krishni and a father called Sutapas. So the Shilpis have a tradition of Krishna lineage. Ojas was an early incarnation of Krishna according to the Shilpis of the Chalukya period. So the nature of the artist, it, there should be an inherent, vibrant, passionate artistic talent within an artist to convey what he or she means to others. That makes the seal of an artist, originality of an artist, because it is that by that he expresses himself, the self-expression in art. The artist's guna is reflected in his creation because it is integrated within the Atman of the artist. It is said that the food is needed for the growth of the body, literature and art for the growth of the mind, and values are for the refining of the self. And the Shilpa Shastra says that a human being, a Shilpi, should have all these type of growth, physical, mental, intellectual and spiritual growth, and he should be a ripe, wise individual, a refined self. That is important for a Shilpi. This is how the Brahmina, it is from the Vishwakarma Brahmins, our tradition of Nambudiri traditions, our Brahmin traditions gradually developed. So the Ashari and Acharya were not actually different in the early part of the tradition. The Shilpis of the cave temples and monolithic temples of Mamallapuram, we have names like Kevada Perundachan, Tachan Gunamallan, Payyamiriyappan and Abhajan. Many of them have got this name Perundachan attached to their first name. And in Brihadeshwar we have Kunjaramallan Raja Raja Perundachan as the Shilpi. And in the Uttaramerur Vimana, the Shilpi is Parameshwara Perundachan. In Therivettiyur Thukkananga Kshetra it is Revi Perundachan. So in all these places there is Perundachan. In Kerala, which is considered to be the original place of the Perundachan, we just use the name Perundachan. We don't have a name for that Perundachan. It is very surprising. We don't have the name, but we have the Uli and the Morakkal of the Perundachan in many temples, especially the ancient temples like Pandiyur, in Hariganiyur, all our ancient temples, all of these places we have that. But we just say that it is done by Perundachan. Which Perundachan? At what time? Nobody says. Only from the antiquity of the temple we can assume. But these temples in Tamil Nadu are comparatively newer temples. And they have given in writing the name of the Shilpi with their first name and then the Perundachan coming second, which shows that all these Perundachan might have moved from the original home to the eastern part, that is to the Tamil Nadu. Anyway, all the textbooks on Indian iconography are written in Sanskrit but in Granthavari script, and all of them are in verse, in poem. So all these things are actually known by learning the text itself. The kavita also comes to them because it is written in verse. Now in a Shilpi's work, a three-dimensional space is made into a verbal form, first in a poetic form, then that poetic form is visualized in your mind, and then it is made into a visual art. So unless you have a knowledge of that particular subject, you will not understand the text. That is why people are not understanding Vastu Shastra. Unless you know the subject, you will not understand Vastu. You have to know mathematics first. Only then you will understand Vastu. It is the same with Jyotisha. You know, Jyotisha also is like that actually. Unless you know mathematics behind it, unless you know the super symmetry and also the relationship between this world and that world, that is the angle, the parallax laws, all these things, if you don't know, the textual thing written in the Jyotisha text will not be understood. It is not just for fortune telling. So that is why people, the modern people, are misunderstanding that this is not a Shastra. This is a Shastra. If you know the science of mathematics, if you know the art of the land, if you know the archaeological features of the land, and then if you learn this book, you will understand it. Otherwise, you will not understand it. That is the special way of, because it is just like medicine. If you go and read Grey's Anatomy without being a medical student, will you understand that? No, you will not. It is just like that. The first you should have the experience of the thing. That is why that vocational training was given in the morning hours and then test in the evening. That particular type of learning developed here because of that only. So a Shilpi should know Natya Shastra, Sangeeta Shastra, literature, music and dance, then all the traditions of the society, the Varna Rupa for creating colors for the murals, and for them the Parabrahma, the Vastu Brahma, is the manifested one on the earth, whereas Parabrahma, the Jyotisha Brahma, that is the Kala Purusha, is the unmanifested one. The unmanifested is made manifested in the Vastu, on the ground. That Avyakta is made manifested, Vyakta. Avyakta is made Vyakta on the Vastu. And this, even we are in that way, even we are Vastu Brahma. Jivatma are actually Vastu Brahma in manifested form. We grow, we move, we contain certain things within, then we perish. Just like that, his Vastu also is perishable. After many thousands of years, it perishes. But the true one, the Kala Purusha, the Jyotish Purusha, doesn't perish. So the, if you know the names, and if you know the art, if you know the science of mathematics and how this happened, you can actually recreate the same thing at any time, anywhere. So it is in that way, even that is anadi and ananta. It persists. Even though the form perishes, the science will not perish.